Today is September 15th, 1998. My name is Jeannie Glucksman. I'm conducting an interview today with Rose-Helene Spreiregen. I'm conducting the interview in Washington, D.C., USA, and the language of the interview is English. Today is September 15th, 1998. My name is Jeannie Glucksman. I'm here today conducting an interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen, née Bester, and we're conducting the interview in Washington, D.C., USA, and the language of the interview is English. I'd like to start by thanking you for agreeing to do the interview and by asking you to tell us your name and to please spell it.
My name is Rose-Helene Spreiregen, and to spell it is Rose-Helene. Spreiregen is Spreiregen, and I was born Bester, Bester.
And when were you born?
March 6, 1931.
And how old are you currently?
67.
Where were you born?
I was born in Paris, France.
And could you tell me the names of your parents?
Yes. My mother's name was Rivka, and my father's name was David, Beinwildzweig. And my mother's name was Rivka Bester.
Could you tell me about your father?
My father, I can't tell you actually very much about him, since my parents were married, I believe, had a Jewish wedding only, and they were married, I believe, in 1929. Can't tell you exactly when, in 29, I believe it was the end of it. I was born in March of 31, and my parents separated when I was just an infant, a few weeks old, and I have not had really contact with my father since. I was mostly with my mother and my grandmother.
Tell me about your mother then.
My mother was a very young woman. She was born in 1911, in May 1911. So when I was born, she was barely 20. And it was actually very difficult for her because there was a big depression going on, and she had to take care of me and try to work. She was a dressmaker. It was not very, very easy. And she had very often to, I was also very often with my grandmother, my mother's mother, and very often she had to let me be with in foster homes, even when I was 2 or even 2 or 3. And I would go back and forth between foster homes and my grandmother, mostly. My mother was trying to make a living, being a very young woman, and what can I say about her? She was a wonderful, lively person, very pretty. Eventually she had to put me actually in a, I don't think it's a boarding school, but I don't know what else to call it. It was headed by a rabbi. It was Rabbi Apeloa. And this was, I was 5.5 years old then, which was in 36, 37. And I was there on and off for about 3 years until July of 1939. It was a boarding school, but yet the school was really a public school. We used to all go to public school. We would go to leave in the morning, come back at noon, have lunch, and go back to our boarding, to the public school, and return in the evening. There were some services on Shabbat and I guess for holidays, but I was so young, I really can't remember much about that. What I can remember is that I was going back and forth very often because my mother couldn't always pay the tuition, so I had to be taken back. So I would go back, stay with my mother for a while, or stay with my grandmother. But just before the war in July of 39, this was, I was in second or third grade, I'm not sure. This was the distribution of the prix. I was actually a very good student, and I got 3 first prizes and the prize of excellency, which was wonderful. But that was the end of my stay, and I think after July of 39, I was taken back. And I think I must have stayed with my grandmother, but I'm not absolutely sure. I think I did.
When you were at the school and boarding together with other girls, I'm assuming.
Boys and girls.
Did you make friends among those other children?
Yes. The reason, actually, I went to this boarding school is because we had some friends who had their 4 daughters there. And they were very good friends of my mother. Their names was Greenspan. And there were 4 girls. And one, the youngest, was my age. So this is how we knew about the place. The Greenspans were rather Orthodox Jews. And I guess this is why the children who had come from Poland were put in this boarding school, which was in fact not a boarding school since the school was outside. Yes, I made some friends. Well, I didn't make actually some friends. These were the friends I had, and mostly the Leah, I think it was Leah, who was my age, and the one who was about a year or 2 older, I think it was Bella, and there was Adas, and Adas was unfortunately deported. And there was Sonia, the oldest one, who was, I think, 16.
They were all the Greenspan children?
Children, 4 daughters. And they survived. Mrs. Greenspan, I think we can talk about that later, was very sick with tuberculosis.
Yes, we'll talk about that
later.
Tell me, had your people, your family, been in France long?
Not really. My grandmother came with my mother in 1929. It was probably, I think it was 1928, early 1928. I'm not absolutely sure, you see, of that. I believe it was 28 or 29. She came with her daughter, who was my mother.
From where?
From Warsaw, Poland. They were born there. And my grandmother had already 2 sisters living in Paris who were married, who had children. And my uncle, my mother's brother, had already come before. And I guess he was sent out before because he was 3 years or 4 years. He was born 1907. He was 4 years older than my mother, and I think he was sent out because I guess he wouldn't have to serve in the military in Poland, which was not too wonderful. So since my grandmother had already 2 sisters living here, and one had emigrated to America, actually lost complete track of her and her husband and her children. But the two living in France actually was, it was very good for my uncle because he was all alone. He had two aunts and their husbands. He must have left maybe in 27. And my mother and grandmother came probably in 28.
So were any of the adults French citizens?
None of the adults, as far as I know, were French citizens. They were all Poles. They were all coming from, they all came from Poland. At least my great aunts, I mean my grandmother's sisters, came from Warsaw. They were Polish. I do not believe that they ever became French citizens. The children who were born here, some may not have been born here, but I really do not know who was and who was not. The ones who were born here were French citizens.
Did that distinction matter? Was there a distinction made between French-born Jews and foreign-born Jews before the war started?
I don't think it matters. It mattered. In fact, I really don't think so. But I was so young that I really am not aware of that detail. It was something that I can't remember.
Was your family religious?
My grandmother was. She was rather Orthodox, and she came from a very Orthodox family. And I am not sure if it was her father or her grandfather who was a rabbi in Poland, but my mother was not. My uncle was not either, as far as I could remember.
Do you remember any large family celebrations of holidays?
I really don't. I can't remember that because I don't know if my grandmother's sisters had any. And I was away quite a lot, being either in foster homes or at this rabbi's boarding school. So I wasn't home that much for big celebrations, if there were any.
What was that like for you, making transition back and forth between living with your mother or your grandmother or at the boarding school?
Well, I guess I didn't know any better. You know, when I was put in a, when I was with foster people, well, that's what I had to do. And when I was in a boarding school, that's the way it was.
Were your mother or grandmother able to visit you when you were at the boarding school?
Yes, she did visit me, but not very often because it was the boarding school was in Louvain, which was not very far from Paris. It was the west great suburbs of Paris, and it was the visits were allowed only on Sundays, and it was not always easy for her to do that. On occasions, I have had a visit. Well, she would visit sometimes, and my grandmother would visit. My aunt has come with my uncle, I guess, to visit with my little cousin. But I didn't have too many visits, I must say. It was difficult. And there was something quite interesting, actually. On Sundays, this was visiting day, Sunday afternoon. You could do, you know, this was a boarding school, so they always wanted some volunteers to help do dishes and do things like that. I remember that sometimes I volunteered on a Sunday afternoon because I knew that my family would not come. So rather than see other parents come through the gate, it was a little bit difficult, and I didn't want to appear not having anyone. So I would go and help do dishes. But I remember, too, that you had to be 6 years old. They didn't want to you to be in the kitchen if you were younger. And I was asked once how old I was, and I said I was six. In fact, I was 5 and a half. And I remember the first thing I did once when my mother came through the door without even greeting her. The first thing I said is, if anyone asks you how old I am exactly, tell them I'm 6. And I had to explain that she had to tell them 6 because 5 and a half would not be a good age. They wouldn't accept me. And then I would be out wandering around in the park when other parents were coming to visit. And it was difficult.
How would you describe yourself as a child? Were you a prankster? Were you serious?
I was very shy, and I was very serious.
Did you take part in any sporting activities?
I don't remember. I really don't. No, don't think so.
Do you remember in the late 30s, you were quite young, but do you remember any talk about how Jews were being treated in Germany or Austria? Do you recall anything? Any talk about Nazis?
I remember, yes, I do remember, because when I would come home during my visits back and forth, all the people talked about, my mother's friends and my relatives, was the war which was going to happen, the war which was just about to break out. And it was so scary. Yes, I do remember that the Jews were having a very tough time in Germany. And starting in 38, I think, and people were starting to come out and try to settle in France. And France was accepting Jews, refugees, for quite a long time. What you needed is, I'm not sure if you need an Ausweis or something like that to be able to come and to be legal. But it was very difficult to come by. And I think I remember my mother once tried to, someone who had arrived who wasn't legal or who came from Germany, and she tried to find her someone who was a French Jew so she could marry him and therefore not be sent back. And there was some talk about that. I can't remember what happened, if it ever did happen. But I do remember that people were trying to help each other any way they could.
Was there any fear that members of your family might not be able to remain in France?
No, once they were in France, they were legal, so they could remain. That was not a problem at all. And I don't believe anyone foresaw what happened after the Germans came to France and Europe invaded. I don't believe they thought that anything terrible was going to happen to them in France, of all places. No, they thought that once you came to France as a refugee, well, you were reasonably safe.
Did you experience any anti-Semitism before the war?
I don't remember that. I really don't.
Were you comfortable among Gentiles?
I guess I was, but I was mostly with, I would say, Jewish families. So I don't think I ever had the experience of being exposed, so to speak. And besides, before the war, it was not a problem. It really became one when you started to have to wear the Jewish star, and no, it was really not a problem then until 41, I think.
I'm going to take you back a little from 41. Could you describe what you remember about the German invasion? Where were you at the time? Were you in Paris?
No, I was not in Paris. What happened is the war was declared the 1st of September 1939. At that point, I think the children and elder persons were, if they wanted to, could be shipped out of Paris because they were afraid that Paris was going to be bombed or gassed or whatever. So they were distributing gas masks, but also elder people with young children could become refugees and be sent to the country where it would be safer for them. And this is exactly what happened to my grandmother and my cousin and myself. The three of us were sent as refugees somewhere, a little village called Savigny-sur-Braye. And I think my mother and my aunt accompanied us but came back. And we were left in the care of my grandmother.
Could you tell me your grandmother's name?
Her name was Sarah Bester.
And the cousin with whom you were also?
Was Bernard Bester, my first cousin and only first cousin.
I didn't ask you, but you haven't mentioned. Did you have any brothers or sisters?
No, I didn't have brothers and sisters. I was an only child.
So you were together with your grandmother and your cousin Bernard?
Right, and in Savigny-sur-Braye, and that's where we went to school. And we were there with her. We were in a little house, you know, the requisitions, I guess, some lodging for people who were refugees. In early May of 1940,
before you go on, I just wanted to make sure I'm clear on this. Your refugee status, was that something that was given to only Jews or Jews and Gentiles?
No, it was. Had nothing to do with Jews yet. This was anyone who was a young child or who was an elder person could go and be sent to these safe places. We were there going to school, and it was a little quiet village, nothing too dramatic about it. To come and visit, you needed a safe pass, sauf-conduit, because I guess everyone was crazy about having spies all over. So you needed a sauf-conduit, and it was given to whoever needed to come visit, like my mother or my aunt, I guess. You had to have it stamped when you came and had it stamped when you were leaving. It usually was for a few days, and that was the end of that. What else can I say? I remember that in early May, I think this is when Belgium was invaded, or was about to, we started to see columns of refugees, of people who were just coming down, marching down on foot, on bicycles, on whatever they could to escape that and to go wherever there was no Germans yet, not believing that France would be invaded as well. And there were huge columns of people who were coming down actually with whatever they had on their back or a little suitcase. They were hungry. They were thirsty. And it was a huge flow of people, and I remember trying to give them whatever we had because we could give them little things, bread and things to drink and fruit or whatever. And they were marching on. And this is when we knew that things were starting to really unravel, that we would probably be invaded too.
Did you hear or see any signs of invasion?
Well, there were bombings once in a while. And I can't tell you if those were British planes or German planes. I think probably, I really don't know. But there were bombs falling. And I remember there was a place where you wash laundry. Where people go and wash their laundry in a big place. And some bombs fell there. It was almost across the street of where we were living. So it was scary. It was pretty scary for a little kid. And I was about eight and a half or so then.
Were you issued a gas mask?
I can't remember if I got a gas mask. I think the adults got some in Paris, but not where we were. I don't remember. It was very scary, but I don't remember gas masks in Savigny-sur-Braye. I just can't.
Do you know how your grandmother made ends meet, how she was able to get food?
We were not rationed then. If we had a little money, we could buy things. It was not easy, but you could buy things. This was pre-rationing time. It was before we started to have rationing cards and so on. So we could buy things. And I don't think this was a problem. At least I don't remember it being one. The problem was that you couldn't get kosher meat for my grandmother. It was a little problem, but I really don't remember what she did about that, how we managed. I guess maybe we didn't eat meat. I can't recall that.
When did things change? When did that situation change?
What changed and when it changed? When it changed, when the Germans started to march in. And
when was that?
It was, I am not sure if it was end of May or beginning of June of 1940. I am not absolutely sure of that. I know that my mother had come to visit. It was one of her visits. She had come once before. I don't remember exactly when, but she came at that time, May or June, whenever pre-invasion or whenever that was. Trains were still operating, I believe. I think she did. But they stopped really operating because of the bombings and because of hordes of people going and running. Everyone was so scared. When she came, there was some kind of bombing, and she got a shrapnel in her foot. I believe the doctors had left the village, and there was really not much that we could do. And she decided that she had to get back with her infected foot, get back to Paris. So I think my cousin Bernard was left in the care of my grandmother. And I left with my mother. This was in either end of May or beginning of June of 1940.
Okay, we're going to stop now to change tapes, but we'll take up right there where you left off. Tape 2 of the interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen. You were describing returning with your mother to Paris to get treatment for her
shrapnel in her foot.
Yes, please continue.
This was really a big adventure because people were fleeing, coming still down the roads, and these were not highways, we're talking smaller roads. They were coming down, and some others were trying to get in the other direction. It was chaotic, to describe it at best. But we had to get back to Paris. She needed really treatment. And it was frightening. It was difficult. We had to try to find people who had still a little gasoline in their car. And you'd go a few miles, and then the car would stop because there was no more gasoline. And it was, aside from being chaotic, because it was everything under the sun, you had horses and wagons loaded with things, people going, fleeing in one direction or fleeing in the other. You had people on bicycles, people who had cars, who had still a little gasoline, absolutely packed to the brims. The top was packed. Everything was just terribly packed. And you had, of course, lots of people walking and lots of children. And once in a while, with these roads completely filled with people, you'd have an airplane, and you'd hear, and all of a sudden, everyone would run to the sides of the road to take shelter, and you would have some bombing. I don't know if those were the British, the French, or the Germans. I really have no idea. People would say, oh, we can see this is a British airplane or whatever. I have no idea. I don't have a clue. It was about 8 or 9, and I really don't know. All I know is that it was frightening and very chaotic. And when the airplanes would leave and the bombing would stop, we'd come back to the road, and off we would go.
Did you witness any casualties?
I really cannot remember what happened. It seems to me that I saw a horse who was hit, and he was, I don't know if he died or he was wounded. I have no idea. And I cannot remember casualties. All I know, it was so tremendously chaotic that I don't know who stayed on the sides of the road or who didn't. Whoever could pick themselves up and go would continue. And it seems to me that, I don't know. I really cannot tell. All I know is that it was scary, and it was just like a nightmare.
How long did this trip take you?
Can't tell. Don't know if it was a day or two or three. I don't remember. I just don't remember. It was, it seems that it took forever, but obviously it didn't take forever. Eventually we got there, but I don't know.
Remind us how old you were at this time.
I was, I just turned 9. So it was a big adventure.
And what did you find when you returned to Paris?
The Germans had occupied Paris at this point, I think. And I'm trying to remember where or when I saw the first German soldier. I am not absolutely sure if it was on the road going to Paris and they were marching down and we were marching up, or if it was once we got into Paris. I really don't remember. What I remember is that they were big, tall, looking really formidable to a child, a young child with big boots and powerful. That's all I can remember, this power oozing out of them, marching down, and as if they were in conquered territory, which in fact they were.
Do you remember seeing weapons, artillery, tanks?
I don't remember. I remember that what was the most scary to me were those soldiers. And they looked like they could do anything, so powerful and so well-dressed and so impeccable. I don't remember any arms. I don't remember any of that.
Were you afraid?
Very much so. Very much so. And I was afraid also because I remember people talking about World War One and saying what the Germans had done. They had spread nerve gas, you know, those mustard gas, and so many people had remained disabled forever after that. So this was very scary also. Said, well, could they do something like that? A child doesn't know. And when you hear adults being scared, it's even more scary for a child. So the adults were scared, so the children were scared.
Was your mother able to find some medical help for her leg?
Yes, I think she did. When we got to Paris, she had a very infected foot, but eventually it was taken care of, and whatever had to be done was done. But it was very difficult to travel with someone who also had a problem with a foot. And this was, I think, a shrapnel that she got from one of the bombings in that village, Savigny-sur-Braye.
What sort of life did you return to once you got back to Paris?
I'm not really quite sure because I was such a young child. And I guess things started to settle. The Germans had occupied Paris by then. And people who were refugees started to come back. I am not absolutely sure at what point the trains started to operate again because obviously the trains were not operating too well. They had been bombed. But things started to get reorganized, I guess, after June or July. I'm not sure of the dates, 1940. But this is, I guess, when people started to get back and to start hoping to start living again with the Germans in their backyard, so to speak. That wasn't fun.
Did it seem to you that a normal life resumed?
Normal. What's normal? For me, nothing was ever normal. It was another moment of chaos in my life. After my younger years, I guess when my grandmother came back, I guess I went to live with her. I started to go to school again.
When would that have been?
Well, I believe that it would have been probably in September. This is when school resumes. This was June, end of June, July, August. This is vacation time anyway. So I guess we had time to straighten ourselves out by then. And in September, I guess I went back to school. My thing was I used to go to different schools. I always had to change schools because I was always pulled from wherever I was. I was in Louvain before the war, and then I went to school in Savigny-sur-Braye, then came back from Savigny-sur-Braye and went to school Rue Saint-Bernard, where my grandmother lived. She lived Rue Bafroy. And there was a constant change of school places. And but this was, I was a good trooper. I was used to these things. As I said, I was, I don't know if I said it, but I was a very serious, mature child. So, and I guess, well, I started to go to school, and then very soon, it probably was in the fall, early fall of 1940, that the Jewish laws, anti-Jewish laws, started. And the first thing was that the Jews had to register with their police precinct. Every Jew. And that's where the fun started. A Jew was even someone who had a grandparent or a great-grandparent who was a Jew, was considered a Jew, even if they had intermarried and were living with Catholics and for all practical purposes were not Jewish anymore. They were considered as Jews for the Germans. So this was done in the fall. It could have been in September. I'm not absolutely sure. I think it was September of 1940. And all sorts of anti-Jewish laws started. And I can't tell you exactly when things started for the Jews, that you couldn't go to a cafe or you couldn't go to a movie theater, to a theater. You couldn't do all sorts of things. You couldn't own a radio. You couldn't. You had to give up all sorts of things. I think it was, how should I put it, rather demeaning because you had to do all this. But I think it really started in earnest when you started to wear the Jewish star. You were issued, every person was issued three Jewish stars, and they had to be worn at all time. They couldn't be attached with pins or with safety pins. They had to be sewn. And since you only had three, they had to be sewn each time and unsewn each time you wanted to wash your shirt or your blouse or whatever the case was. We had to start wearing them in June 1941. And in May, actually, of 1941, this was the first roundup, actually, of foreign Jews. And they got notices that they had to present themselves willingly, otherwise they would be fetched. They should go to their police station the next day or 2 days later, or whatever the case was. And some of the relatives did that, including my uncle Bernard's father, and I never came back.
What was his name?
Shamil Bester. He was taken and sent to Pithiviers, which was one of the holding camps. There were others. One was called Beaune-la-Hollande. This was where some distant cousins went. They were held there. And there was, I think it was Pithiviers and Beaune-la-Hollande. Those were the camps where they were held for quite a bit. In fact, they were held there until they were deported, and the deportation took place. They were there in May 1941, and they were deported. Most of these camps were emptied out in June 1942 to make room for what was to come.
Was there any form of communication between your aunt or your grandmother and your uncle in Pithiviers?
Yes, there was. They were permitted, it seems, one postcard a month, no letter, but a postcard. Because this way, everyone could read what it said. yes, I think there were visits, not often. It seems to me that my aunt and my grandmother went to visit once, but you couldn't go inside the camp. You had to be outside. Excuse me. I guess it was a prison, so you could only see from outside the bars or whatever the enclosure was. I'm not sure how you could do that if you had to. You had to have a permit. I know that to go to that thing, but and I don't know if you had permission for more than one person, two people. I guess the wife could go. I suppose the mother, and maybe the son. But it was, I don't believe they went more than once or twice.
Do you know if there was any sense among the adults of what would become of the people who were interned in PTV?
No, as long as they were not starting the deportation, I don't think anyone could imagine what would happen. So it was bad, obviously, to be in this camp, but as long as they were there, it was bad, but it wasn't, no one had any inkling of what was about to happen.
What was life like for you and your mother and your grandmother, your cousin, during that period? Were there any further changes in the way you were allowed to live?
Well, there were changes, great changes, in fact, because after June 41, when you became extremely visible with your star, which you had to wear, you could not, first of all, there was a curfew. That was number one. The curfew, there was actually a general curfew for everyone, the whole population, but if the curfew was, let's say, 9 or 10 for the general population, which I think it was, for the Jews, I believe it was 6 p.m., so they had to be in before that, because if they were found on the street with a star, they would be arrested. There were other things which were pretty difficult. You could travel in the metro, and you could only use the last car. You were not permitted in any of the other ones. To do your shopping, you were only allowed to go between 11 and 12. This was actually a very bad time because the merchants would close to go to get their merchandise at that time. And by then, whatever was left, even with coupons, was not very much. So it was difficult at best, and also lines were for everyone. So since we had to stand in line, if you stood in line for an hour in one place, well, you couldn't go shopping anymore. This was it for the day. It was that. So you had to wait the next day to get something else. You couldn't have a radio, I know that. You couldn't have, you had to give up all these things. I'll try to remember what the other things were, and they don't just come to my mind.
Were you permitted to continue with school?
I was permitted. We were permitted. The only problem with that permission was that they would come and pick the children out of the classes. So after... Well, I went to school until July 42, until the big roundup, which took place the 16th and 17th of July 1942. This was the Vélodrome d'Hiver roundup, where they took, this was the French police, I must say, where they took women, children, men, I mean, everyone indiscriminately. Foreigners, that is. At that point, they were not rounding up the French Jews yet. after that, after July of 42, of course, it was vacation time, but I did not go back to school because the children were really picked in the classes. You'd have a star, someone would come and take them out. So it wasn't safe. After that, they didn't go to school.
When you say they were picked and taken out of the class, were they sent home or?
They were deported. They were put in a holding camp, which was Drancy, and shipped out to a final destination.
And even as a child, you were aware of that these things were happening?
Very much so, because some of my schoolmates were picked that way. So it was not safe to go. So after the end of the school year of 42, which was in July, I didn't go to school. Not safe.
Did you witness any roundups or any
Yes.
harassment or mistreatment of Jews?
Mistreatments, no, but I did witness roundups because after July 42, there was, as I said, a curfew for everyone. I think it was maybe 9 or 10. But whenever there was a truck driving on the street, this was always bad news because the truck was full of Germans. And the Germans would, we knew some families where we lived in the area, and truck would stop at a certain street, would say, well, this is for such and such family probably, or so and so. And sure enough, you'd see them come out, you know, trying to be far away from the window, not to be noticed. You could see that the Germans had taken someone and put them in their truck. They were arrested and disappeared. They were probably sent to Drancy, where they were sorting people out. This was a holding camp before they were shipped out to the extermination camps. But in those days, no one knew about that. It was very scary, but we didn't know where they were going, and we were hoping for the best. They were sent to Germany to work. Big joke.
Did you feel safe in your own home?
No, I didn't feel safe at all in my own home. But at that point, my mother was arrested in July. I think I have to come to it in a more orderly way. When there was this roundup, the 16th of July, 42, before that, a day or so before, my mother happened to know a policeman. I don't know how she had known him. And he came to warn her that there was going to be a roundup of Jews to go to hide. So she went in hiding. She was not there when they came to arrest her.
They came to your apartment?
They came to the apartment, right. At that, in July of 42, I think it was vacation time, and I was with my grandmother. There was another thing that you could not do for Jews. You could not leave Paris. You couldn't go further than 25 kilometers, which was maybe 17 miles or so from Paris. So one of my grandmother's sister had a little house in the suburbs of Paris, in fact. This was a little sort of vacation house, a little shack. And I guess I was there with my grandmother. And I think my mother arrived and told us that there was a roundup. And I think news really go very, very fast, despite the fact that we didn't have any telephone. I don't even know if you could have a telephone. She decided that she had to really not only warn us, but she had to get back as soon as possible within a couple of days to try to find a way to escape to the free zone. And I really do not know. There were other families who had this problem, and she must have known some friends who had that. I don't know how exactly. But she found someone who would transport her, so to speak, to the free zone with a group of other Jews. And she had to go and get an ID photo to have some false papers made within a day or so. And I really don't know how this happened, how she found people to do it. But it was done, and she left with this group. And this person was going to help them pass, paid in advance. We, my grandmother and I, stayed because since they didn't know where they were going, it was safer to stay and wait until they had arrived and found a place to, so it would come. Well, this didn't happen. They were arrested, crossing the line going to Free France, and the town in which they went to, they were arrested was Autun. Autun, and it's A-U-N-T-I-N. And that's where she was put in prison. And then she was there a few days. This was probably 25th or 26th of July, 42. Then she was shipped to, I'm not sure if it was Pithiviers, and then to Drancy. And Drancy is where she was deported. She was deported in the 19th of August, 1942. And she was left. She left, how should I put this? They were forming trains, and each train, I believe, had to have about 1,000 people. And they were asking to, if there were volunteers to convoy children in some of the wagons. From what I understand, my mother was a volunteer to be one of the two people in a convoy, in a wagon with children. The reason we learned about this is that Mrs. Greenspan, who was the mother of the friends of ours who were in Lucien, had been arrested with one of her daughters. The three others escaped with her father. But she, I think, stayed behind, didn't believe she would be arrested because she had terminal tuberculosis and she felt that maybe she would be safe. Well, she wasn't safe. She was arrested with one of her daughters. And she was eventually released, and I don't know how this happened. She was sent back home, and this must have been in September or October 42. And she told us that she saw my mother, and she's the one who knew that she had volunteered for a children's convoy with another woman. Every wagon had to have at least two adults. And what I did not know then, I felt that maybe, well, she would be saved this way. What I learned much later, years later, is that women who had volunteered to be with convoys of children were, if they were not dead on arrival, were gassed on arrival. So there was not very much of a chance that my mother would ever come back. But I learned this much later.
We have to change tapes and we'll pick up right there. clip three of the interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen, you were describing how you learned about what had become of your mother after she was arrested for trying to cross over into the free zone. Could you please continue?
Well, after that, we obviously tried to get some information, tried to get any kind of, but we did not. Once you were arrested, when she was arrested, apparently she got a card somehow and sent it out of the train, and it arrived. So we knew that she had been arrested, and this is what we knew. When she was, I'm not sure I knew that she was in PTV or somewhere else. I got this through the French papers that I got years later. But I knew she was in Drancy, and she was deported from Drancy. I guess everyone was, I suppose, eventually. After August 1942, there was really absolutely no news anymore of what had become of her. We were fearing the worst, but hoping that maybe the Germans needed people to work for them, and maybe they were like the prisoners of war, and they were in Germany to work. But we were not absolutely sure about that. It was really very frightening, because once they were gone, you had no idea where they were and what was happening. And also, people continuously were arrested, the ones who were hiding still in Paris. And what happened after that, when my mother was arrested, my grandmother and I moved to her apartment feeling that it was safer, because since she was arrested, they wouldn't come again. Well, it wasn't quite that. It was, they came again, and we had sort of to bribe the concierge so she wouldn't say anything and give a little things. But it was safer than to be at my grandmother's place, where they hadn't come to arrest her yet, as here the person had been arrested, so therefore it was, there was no reason to come again. What happened at this point is that my grandmother started to hide in the apartment and never left the apartment. So she was in hiding for all practical purposes from July 42 to August 43, when we finally left to go to the free zone. And what happened during that time, I was the go-between between her world, I mean the outside world, and the hidden world, so to speak. So I was going around doing whatever I needed to do, the shopping, doing what had to be done outside. Trying not to be too conspicuous, although they were not arresting French Jews yet, but it didn't take much for them to be to arrest one if you didn't, for example, perform the way you were supposed to, like travel in the second train rather than the last wagon of the metro, or if you, whatever, you were found shopping afternoon rather than from your allocated time from 11 to 12. And I can tell you it was difficult enough to get any kind of food, as it was, with coupons or not coupons. It was just very difficult.
Did you have your own identification papers?
Well, what I had is, of course, I didn't have IDs. I had a certificate of birth or whatever, being a child, a young child. I didn't need anything, because you got, as long as you were registered, you got your tickets automatically. So this was not, these things were totally independent of each other. Fortunately, we got the tickets, so this was not the problem. The problem was that, aside from the fact that the Germans were coming to pick people all the time, so you had to really not antagonize the concierge or anyone, so she would spill the beans, so to speak, and tell that we were in hiding. We had to be very careful. My grandmother, of course, as I said, did not go out. And I was going, and at the time I was 11, so I was a little adult doing all the things which needed to be done, bringing bags of things, loading up bags and bringing things over to my grandmother's place, hoping that since she was an elder person, maybe they wouldn't touch the apartment and nothing would happen. And basically, that's what it was. I couldn't go to school, so I had to stand in line to get food and do things like that. And that's about...
Can you describe what your food rations were like?
The food rations, what they were like. I can't give you quantities for certain things, but I remember meat. That was rather interesting because we were allocated 90 grams with bone and 72 grams without bone, because obviously when there is bone, you need more, which is without bone, I would say about 2.5 ounces to translate it into weights that you would know.
And how long did that have to last you for?
This was per week. So sometimes, obviously, you couldn't get a tiny amount like that, so you'd wait 2-3 weeks to accumulate enough coupons to get a little piece of something, which wasn't very much, and there wasn't very much. You couldn't get things without tickets. What you could get without tickets is, I think, fish heads and maybe fish, but fish, it was a very interesting way, the way it was allocated. You didn't need tickets, but what you needed is to register with, let's say, the fish store. And you'd be given a number, and your number would be 3,255. And every week or so, there would be about 10 customers were permitted to have whatever came in, not much. It meant that during the war, I can't remember seeing fish except maybe for a fish head, which was delightful because we made soup with it. But and if by mistake you didn't go by the store where it said 3,250 to 3,260 and you were among them, well, then you had to go back to the beginning and forgo your possibility of getting that little fish. So that was not very helpful because you didn't get very much. There were lots of things we never saw during the war, and I remember during the war I kept saying when we had really nothing, after the war, when the war is over, what I really would like is to get a can of sardine, oil sardines, you know, wonderful can of sardine, and a steak, and French fries, and an orange, and a banana. That would be just heaven. Of course, we didn't have any of that, and it took years before we got that after the war, because after the war, we were still Russian for quite a long time.
You were a growing child. Did you have any milk?
Well, not much. And I'll get to that later when we get to Voiron. We got... My grandmother didn't get any, and if she did, it was like one cup every 2 or 3 days she was permitted. I'm not even sure of that. And I got not much more than that being a child. It was very difficult. Of course, there were no cheeses and things like that. it was, well, we didn't have any of these things, and sugar was rationed. Of course, butter was rationed. Everything was rationed. The bread became like sawdust. I don't know what they put in it. It was just awful. We needed tickets, of course, for that as well. It was... we didn't eat much, let's put it this way. Potatoes were not rationed, I don't think, and we couldn't get too many of those. Rutabagas were not rationed either. But that was awful. This is what you fed the pigs. during the war, we were happy to have something because you make soup with it. I'm trying to remember what wasn't Russian, but there were so few things which were not. Fruit, I don't think, were Russian. And we got some, but not an awful lot, obviously not oranges and bananas, which came from other countries. So we had things like peaches and apples and things, which is better than nothing.
Was there a black market?
There was very much so, very much so. If you had money, you could get about anything you wanted or needed. You could get meat and cheese and milk and anything. And what is very interesting, there is something, people who had the milk stores, what is that called? Maybe you can help me. What is when you have milk,
dairy?
Cheese? Yeah, dairy store, that's it. People who had a dairy store made lots of money because many were selling things on the black market, and they became quite wealthy, in fact. And this is what we call the nouveau riche. And these people had a very funny name. We called them BOF, which meant beurre, œuf, fromage. So this was, they would say, the nouveau riche, beurre, œuf, fromage, BOF. It told you everything you needed to know after the war. So they made money. I assume the people who had meat could also sort of cheat and make money. But yes, if you had the money, which we didn't have, you could manage to eat okay.
You were a growing child, I suspected. Did you have any childhood diseases, any sicknesses during this time?
Not that I can remember, I guess, colds and things like that. But no, I was very slender child, but not a sick child. I can't remember being having anything terrible.
And how was your grandmother's health?
My grandmother's health was not so wonderful, but we made do with the way we could. It was she was not in very good health. She had rheumatism and arthritis and all sorts of wonderful things.
Were there any pharmacies?
Yes,
any
there were pharmacies. There was medication, and there were doctors too. There were.
Could you go to a non-Jewish physician?
Yes, because the Jewish physicians had either disappeared or were, how should I put it, non-Jews had taken over. It's the same thing with people who had stores after the Jewish anti-Jewish laws happened. People who had businesses were taken over by non-Jews, and the Jews were permitted to sort of work and get some kind of little money out of that. But for all practical purposes, it was the non-Jews who had taken over who were making the decisions and doing whatever had to be done. It was a wonderful time.
Was there any assistance? Was there some form of organized Jewish community? Were there any institutions that could help you?
There was OSE, and I don't remember how they got to us, how we found them, or they found us. I must open a parenthesis here, because once my mother was deported, we were extremely eager to try to find out what had happened to the people who were deported. And there was some sort of a rumor, which may not have been a rumor. There was a Jewish organization, I can't remember what they were called, which had possibilities. The Germans were giving them some information, obviously not that, not telling them where the Jews had been taken to. And I found myself trying to find out, and I went to this office, which I learned about, I don't remember where it was. It was mostly French Jews who were taking care of that, It was a Jewish organization, which I don't remember the name of. And I came to get information. Well, the waiting room was absolutely packed, loaded with people who had the same idea as I did. And when time came to close at 5 or whenever it was, because we had to observe the curfew, they said, okay, we can't accommodate you, you can't get in, it's, you know, you have to come back. Well, I couldn't see how, when I come back, it would be better. And as I said, I was a very shy child, but a very determined one. And I said, I'm not going. When they were throwing me out, I said, I'm absolutely not going. I'm going to stay here until I learn what happened. Well, every adult had gone, and here was this child insisting on not leaving. It was rather strange thing. And eventually, the people were outside the office, the front desk, if you want, went to get some higher up inside the office and took him out and said, well, here's this child. We can't throw her out. She doesn't want to go, and she wants to know what happened, blah, blah, blah. And there was, in this office, a Mr. André Dreyfus, who was working there, who was, I learned after, a wonderful person, because he saw this child, very determined child, and I said, no, I'm not going, and I want to know, since I understand you have news, and I want to know what happened, and I'm told to come back, and when I come back, it's going to be the same thing, I'm not going to be able to see you. So he saw that this was a remarkable kind of thing for a little girl who was 11 to be so persistent and so determined. And he said something which was so sweet. He said, look, why don't you come and have lunch at my house with my wife? And if I get any information, anything, I'll bring it for you. Which was very nice. But then again, I said, well, this is, maybe he doesn't have a wife, maybe he's trying to lure me into something terrible. And I was debating, should I go? What should I do? Well, I decided I was going to go. I had to go. So I went. He had given me the address of the place, and a maid opened the door. I didn't know if this was the wife, but at least there was another woman. And sure enough, his wife was there, and there was a daughter, actually two. One was her daughter and one was his. They had both been remarried. And they sort of, if I say, they sort of adopted me, because they were wonderful people. They thought that I was such a terrific little kid. I came all dressed up with white little gloves, with a little straw hat, very elegant, and here I came to lunch, and I came to here. So they liked me, and I became sort of a part of the family. And I would come after that. I was invited every week to have lunch with them. And since I couldn't call them sir or missus or whatever, they decided the best thing to do would call to say parrain and marraine, which means godmother and godfather, which was very sweet. And I became the godchild, in fact, of these people, the Dreyfuses, Sonia and André Dreyfus. They were terrific people, really. And
now it sounds to me as if their lifestyle was
quite different. They were sort of higher class and quite different.
And able to maintain their pre-war class status?
Well, not quite, but they were French Jews. And being French Jews at that point, they didn't have to worry as much, which doesn't mean that it didn't happen, because a little while after that, his son was in the metro somewhere and was arrested and never seen again. So it was, and yet his first wife was not Jewish. So his two children, he had a son and a daughter, well, were, for all practical purposes, not Jewish for the Jews, but very much Jewish for the Germans. And the daughter was married to a non-Jew. I don't believe she ever registered, which was a very wise thing to do. She was married to a non-Jew, had two little girls. Anyway, Andre Dreyfus and Sonia Dreyfus were my godparents for the war and after the war. We were very good friends, and they sort of, since I was the overseer of my grandmother in a way, they were a little bit overseeing me, helping me, because I was the adult almost with an old grandmother, and they were helpful. So, what else is there?
What did you learn about, was he able to help you learn about your mother's whereabouts?
Unfortunately not, because they didn't get much information. It was really a window dressing more than anything. There was really nothing. I didn't learn anything. They didn't have any information. And really no one had any clue as to what was happening to the people who were deported. This went on for a while, and until my grandmother, I said, was hiding in that my mother's apartment. What was difficult too was, it was very difficult. In fact, is when there were air raids, we couldn't leave. That was very scary, because there was some bombing of Paris, and sometimes you'd feel the walls shaking and your bed shaking, but you couldn't go to the shelters.
And why was that?
Because it was the curfew, because we couldn't go out at night, because someone could have denounced us and someone could have picked us up, and it was so easy to do that. And also during those terrible times, terrible rationing, the French, who many French, not all, because some were so helpful, many French were very anti-Semitic. And if you didn't have any food, guess what? It's not because it went to Germany. It was because the Jews ate it. And so therefore, it made life very uncomfortable for me, especially when I was standing in line with my Star of David and hearing all these horrible things said about the Jews, how they were terrible and mean and eating everything and doing all these horrible things. And here I was, this poor little kid, hearing all that and could not even defend myself, couldn't say, but this is not so. It was scary and it was dehumanizing. And since I hadn't even had some real role models, you know, if I was told, if I heard that all the Jews were so terrible and despicable, obviously that's what I was. So I always wanted to be better than anyone else, do better than anyone else, to prove that I wasn't what those anti-Semites made me to be, which I was not. I was a very good child, and I was made to feel that there was really a less than dirt. That's difficult. So, we were in this apartment until 1943, August 1943. And then things started really to heat up, because there were more roundups, because you could see that the Germans were coming more often with their trucks. And it was a matter of time before we were caught.
So, did you ever have to physically hide, flee from the apartment?
Yes, we had to do that, because some nights when we heard that some roundups were happening, and there was always a string of people who knew, who had told someone who were relaying, that we had in the building, we had some wonderful people who lived there. They had a little laundry. And they were doing laundry. Their name was Paul and Yvonne Martin. The Martins were really the most wonderful people. And they several times let us spend the night in the store, which was really very risky for them. I remember when sleeping on the ironing table, they had this big, big table. We slept there. And we, the store, of course, was locked and closed, but you could hear the Germans going and coming in front of the door, and it was really very scary. We had once to go to, there was an attic in that place, and we went in the attic for a night. I don't remember what the reason was. We must have heard something was going to happen. We felt that it was really getting too uncomfortable to stay. And during that time that we met, that I met the Dreyfuses, my godparents, in fact, they had contacts with people of DOZ and people like that. And I think they are the ones who dispatched a social worker from there to come and visit and see us.
Do you know what the OSE stands for?
It's Œuvre de Secours aux Enfants. And what happened is one of these people, social workers, came and wanted me to leave and go to a home for children in hiding. Well, I refused to do that. I didn't want to abandon my grandmother. I couldn't leave her. She could not really have survived alone. Her French was not so wonderful. And she would not have known what to do. I was really the link between the outside world and her. So I refused to do that. I stayed with her. We really were so strapped for money. My mother had taken the money with her and thinking that we would just follow. So we had very little money. Jose, she decided to give something to me since I was a child, a little amount of money per month. I don't remember how much this was, but very little, but yet helpful. It was better than nothing. This went on for a few months, and then we got the idea that we had to leave. And how we found someone who was in the underground who could make us false papers, I have no idea. I don't remember how this happened. But it happened, and we got some false papers. And how we picked the name is sort of interesting, because in my grandmother's building, there was a lady who died, and her name was, I think, Jeanne Désert. So my grandmother took the name Jeanne Désert, and I became Rose Désert, got papers. And that's the way we picked the name. That was as good as any.
And I'm afraid we're running out of the film, so I think we should pause now and mm-hmm. we'll pick up the story on the next tape. Tape 4 of the interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen.
I think it's 3.
You were telling us that about making preparations for trying to get to the south of France, to the free zone. Please continue.
Right. In the meantime, I have to say, though, that we had been in contact with my aunt, Ellen, Haya, if you want, and my cousin Bernard, and they were on the run. They had been to I don't know how many places in France, hiding to different spots. And eventually, they were at this point in August of 43, they were in a town called Voiron. And this was near Grenoble, southeast of France. And we had to leave because it really became clear that we couldn't stay any longer, otherwise we could be picked up anytime, and we had to go. So we found someone who wasn't the resistance, who I don't know how, through whom, someone who would do false papers for us. And she did. And we got false papers, and it was decided to leave sometimes in August of 43. And I cannot remember if we went on our own to the station or if she came to help us to get there. I really have absolutely no recollection of that at all. Anyway, we took the train, and we got to Voiron. And before we did that, we had to pass through the zone, the free zone, the occupied zone to the free zone. And this was a little bit scary, since my mother had been arrested there. Anyway, in order to minimize problems, I told my grandmother, as we were getting closer to this passage, that she should make believe that she was sleeping. It was at night anyway. We traveled overnight. And she shouldn't say anything, make believe that she was just sound asleep, that I would take care of the papers and of the going through with the German police and the French police. She wouldn't have to do a thing. I then wanted to do a thing. Her French was not very good. And since she assumed the identity of a French person, it was just as well if she didn't open her mouth too much. Anyway, we did that. And I was obviously very scared because, after all, I was a 12-year-old assuming the adult role, when, in fact, someone should have been protecting me. An adult should have been protecting me, the child. And everything went well. There was no problem.
We stopped at the border in any way?
Yes, we did stop at the border. And the German police came on and the French police came on. I don't know in what sequence, but they were all there. And I just gave the papers and I said, that's my grandmother and she's asleep. You could see she was asleep. No one was going to bother her. She was looking elderly anyway. And fortunately, I must say I was more dead than alive. I was so afraid. But it worked. It was no problem. And here we were, in the free zone.
Had you taken any precautions or done anything to sort of support your non-Jewish identity? Did you have any Christian artifacts with you?
Or? No, we had none, because many, many French people are really agnostic. They are not particularly Catholic. And, for example, the Martins, I am sure, never set foot in a church ever, because they were not that kind. They were not interested. And what we did, though, before we left, we gave several suitcases of things to the Martins to keep in case something should happen to us. Some silver, some sheets, whatever. I don't even remember what it was. And we gave them also some money to pay for the apartment and for my grandmother's apartment. So every 3 months, you paid every 3 months, it would be paid for, so it wouldn't look like we deserted them and they could be occupied. And it worked. They were, as I said, wonderful people who did it. And we left. We joined my aunt and my cousin, Bernard, who were there already. And for a short while, a short time, we lived with them, but we couldn't stay there very long because they already were living with another lady who also was hiding. Her husband had been deported. And it would have been really too many people at once. It would have really given us away. So we had to go on our own and find something else. So this was actually where they were living, where we were living with them, was maybe 4 or 5 kilometers from Voiron. It was sort of, I hate to say suburbs, it wasn't a suburb, it was in the country.
And did you have a story that you could tell to the local people to explain your sudden appearance?
No, because, well, the way we explained it is that we were refugees. We left Paris because of the bombing, and that was dangerous, and everyone could understand that and sympathize with that. We couldn't tell them that we left because we were Jews in hiding, of course. And the reason my grandmother had this funny accent is because she was originally from Poland, and therefore she was, her accent. So they didn't question it, and they were simple people enough that they wouldn't question it. And besides, their dislike for the Germans were just as bad as ours. So,
do you think that you were perceived as Jews by anyone?
I don't believe so. And if we were, no one ever said anything. I frankly don't think so, but it's possible. It's possible. You know, people were fleeing, were usually refugees from somewhere else. And during the war, you saw all sorts of different people, different nationalities going from one place to the other, believing or hoping that where they were going was going to be better than where they were. So we were another set of refugees, that's all. So that's it.
Did you register at the municipality or at the police?
We probably did, because we needed to get the Russian coupons. So we probably did with our false papers. And that was the end of that, because we needed our coupons. And also, we were so very strapped for money at that point that my aunt was doing shopping in a tiny little, small grocery. And they were looking for someone to help them because it was a woman who was very sick with tuberculosis. She had a little girl. She was living with her two parents, and her husband was a prisoner of war. So she was very disabled, really. And her parents were sort of elderly and couldn't do that much, so she needed someone to run the grocery. And my aunt thought that this would be good for me to do. Remember, I was 12. And I went, and she interviewed me, and she thought that would be, for a 12-year-old, I was pretty mature and pretty put together, was fine. So she hired me. And here I was at 12, running a grocery store, getting coupons from customers and getting all the coupons pasted on whatever it was that we had to do, and going to the different places where you get your food. And this was about 4 or 5 kilometers from where I lived, and of course there was no transportation. So she was kind enough to lend me her bicycle so I could go ride back and forth. This is about, I would say, 3-4 miles, but at least 3 miles. So I would have to do this in the morning and the evening, and it was also in winter. It was fall, winter months. It was in the mountains. So it was not that I would say something extremely pleasant, because I'd ride the bicycle in the morning. I would open the store. I would do whatever during the day. And on the way home, sometimes I'd have to stop to get all the stuff that I needed for the store, or in the morning before I went there. On the little bicycle, I had these boxes of things that I would bring back. And here I was, running the store, the grocery store.
Was there anything in it for you? Did you get paid enough to help ends meet?
I was getting paid, but very little. You know, what do you think? You're going to pay a child. The fact that the child was running the grocery was beside the point. But yes, I was getting paid, not much. The other source of help and income was my grandmother started to go around to the different, she was not interested in the normal person. She was interested in a person who had a butcher shop, or a person who had a bakery, or a person who had whatever that they were selling food-wise. And that was, we started a kind of exchange bartering. She would go, during the war, of course, we couldn't buy anything, shirts, sheets, whatever. And everything had become really pretty shabby looking. So she would go to these different places and say, do you have anything to fix? She remember, she didn't have a sewing machine. It was hands, by hand. Do you have sheets to be fixed? Do you have shirts to turn over the collars or the cuffs or whatever? And everyone had things like that. But she said, okay, I can do that for you, but I don't want to be paid. I want you to pay me in merchandise. Whatever it is, I'll take. So that's the way we started our bartering system. The next bartering system was when we separated from my aunt and my cousin and that other lady, we found a place which had been inoccupied for a million years. It had been used as storage. They don't know they were storing furniture or whatever. It was just storage in a building. It was two little rooms, and it had actually a running water, cold water. Toilet was outside. And we found this. It was very difficult to find a place because there were not many available places. So we found this, and we couldn't not accept it, so we did. The problem with that place is that not only did we have nothing in it, we had to start also finding people who'd lend us a mattress or a pot or whatever, and we gathered different things to be able to make it barely livable. We didn't have an armoire or whatever to put our clothes in, and God knows we didn't have that much. We left with two suitcases. But we needed things. And what was even more difficult is that this place had been, no person had lived in it. It was a storage place. It had lots of mice. And that was such a problem. I was terrified of these mice, as if it didn't have enough terror in my life. I needed extra mice. So we found someone, a neighbor, who had a whole bunch of kids who was getting lots of things that we were not getting. And what he was getting is a lot of milk. Children, when you had a lot of children, you were getting milk. I was getting, since I was an older child, not a 2 or 6 year old, but 12, I was getting, I think it was a cup of milk every 2 days. So it was a half cup per day, which was very little. My grandmother, being an adult, got none. But she was getting, with a coupon, she would get a bottle of wine a week. I was getting a chocolate bar a month. I mean, all of these things that we were not going to touch, it was bartering things. So my chocolate became the bartering thing for someone else who never got, didn't have children, needed it, wanted it. Instead, we got something else. I forget what it was. The wine that my grandmother got became milk for us. We'd get, I think, a cup of milk a day, by getting the wine over. I'm trying to remember what we got for the chocolate. I never touched that chocolate. It was because it was such a precious commodity that we could exchange it for something else. I can't quite remember what we got for it. But anyway, that was one of the things. And the other thing, for a while, even the wine we didn't bother, what we did, we found this man who came, and he was putting traps for the mice because we couldn't do that. And eventually, I think he trapped like 18. I mean, it was unbelievable. And it did also quite a bit of damage because we got a wooden box to fold our clothes to put it in. And we had a blanket, a sort of warm blanket. And in the building where we were in hiding in Paris, there was a dressmaker also in hiding. And she made me a dress out of the blanket. And this was terrific. But the mice liked this nice little dress all folded up and ate a big hole in the middle of my dress. And this was the end of my dress. I couldn't wear it anymore. And I think it was my only warm dress. So that was the end of that. Eventually, we got rid of all the mice to this man. I think we're giving him the wine for a while. He was thrilled, and we were happy to have someone to help us with the mice situation. And as I said, we got milk, not much, but we got eventually to have, I think it was one cup a day, I think we managed to get this way, between what I got and what this other man was giving us with all the children that he had. So with all the bartering, we were not starved, but again, it was very difficult. We got a little stove to cook on and heat the place. And the stove needed wood or coal. Coal we never saw coal. But wood, we had to go in the forest to gather branches or pieces of wood or whatever it was that we could gather. And we would drag it back a few kilometers and saw it up with a handsaw, you know, go and saw it up. And I remember doing this a lot. And but that was not quite enough either, because this was a mountain place, you know, it was cold. What we did do when we had vegetables, we would peel potatoes, carrots, whatever it was that we had, we would dry all these things in the oven. So it would be dry peels. Dry peels are very good to cook with because it helped during the night so the fire wouldn't go out completely.
Also use the peels as fuel.
As fuel. That's why it would dry all the peels and put it in the stove. And I was constantly cutting wood and drying peels. And so we had something to cook on, and it wasn't always very warm, but we had to try not to use everything up. And then things were going for a while quite okay. For several months, as I said, I was in charge of that grocery. And then she decided to sell it because it really wasn't working out too well for her. She needed, I think, also the money. And also for her, it was a big deal to have to deal with that grocery. So she sold it. And I was, of course, out of a job. And so we continued with our bartering and trying to get food for whatever. And it lasted for a while. And in fact, it lasted until August of 44. In August 44, there is something I have to say. I couldn't go to school because I really went too far. I stopped going to this grocery because it was sold, and I couldn't really go to school because it was not so wise to do it even with false papers, because we were the refugees, so you never could tell what was going to happen. And I had a very curious mind, and I was always very eager to learn. And we were very fortunate that across the street from where we lived, there was a big library, public library. And I would take out stacks of books, a huge amount of books. It was wonderful because I read everything and anything, whatever seemed appealing, I would take out, and here it was, across the street. So I'd come back with my stacks of books, and I could do that. But then things got even worse. Is also, we were in an area where there were lots of partisans, a lot of in hiding, and we also were in an area which was notorious for the militias, who were, you know, extreme right sympathizers of the Germans, and this was very bad news. There were a few other Jewish families who were hiding in this town. And one day, one of the militiamen was killed, and they decided to round up, I don't know, 15 or 20 hostages at random, and they really did all sorts of terrible things to them, pulled their nails and did horrible thing, and then shot them. And among these people was someone we knew. It was, they had taken at random, so it was Jews and non-Jews. But there was this Jewish man who had come there with his family, the Kornblum family, who we had met there. And they had two or three children, I'm not sure. She was very pregnant with the other one and with the old mother of this man. And he was taken as a hostage, and he was murdered. So that was very uncomfortable, to say the least, and things were really getting very uncomfortable, too, there. Where were we?
While you were there, did you worry about getting caught?
Of course, because you never could tell who would know or who would discover that you were really not what you were saying that you were. So it was very uncomfortable. So I didn't go to school there. But then something else happened during all of that. My grandmother, who was not very, was very skinny actually, because we really didn't have much to eat. In our two little rooms, there was a step from one room to the other. And she tripped and fell and broke two ribs. And that was difficult because we had to get someone, you know, ribs, you can't do something to heal them. You had to sort of tape them. So after that, she couldn't move, and we found someone to tape her ribs. And she had to lie flat. She couldn't do anything. So here I was in charge of doing everything. Of course, getting the wood in the forest and dragging it back, all those branches and whatever I could find. Sewing it up and getting some food, trying to get something, continue the bartering, doing all of that. Plus, the horrible thought was, if we have to leave now, we cannot go, we're trapped. She couldn't go anywhere. She was bedridden. And we were trapped. And that was, I think, of the whole time we were in hiding, I think this was the most horribly frightening time. Being trapped, but she couldn't go anywhere. She was, she had broken ribs.
And when did this happen? Did she fell and broke her ribs?
Well, it happened sometimes in 43, in early 40. No, not 43. What am I saying? Early 44. It happened early 44, and we were stuck, and we felt that if anything happened, if there was roundups of people, if someone denounced us or whatever, we couldn't go anywhere. And that's very, very scary. So here we were.
At this point, let me just to clear up a point. Who were you afraid of being denounced to?
We knew some people around, and some of them, I would say most people were pretty nice, and they were also, some of them were in the resistance. But some others were sort of pro-German, and you never could tell who it was. And you couldn't tell if someone wasn't going to say, well, why don't you check out these people who have a funny accent or whoever. You know, they say their name is Désir, but this is not the way they talk. It can't, I mean, whatever. You couldn't tell. And it was a possibility. And the possibility was also that there would be bombings if we were liberated. We didn't know if we wouldn't have to start running again because of that. And, of course, we heard of that the liberation was started, that the D-Day started on June 6, 1944 in Normandy. So we felt that we really were maybe going to be liberated soon, and things were maybe going to happen. But in the meantime, the militia became really extremely bad, and they were running around, and there were lots of also of what you call that partisans who were going and coming and doing things. So you never could tell who was going to be arrested for what reason, and if someone was not going to kill a militiaman again, and they would round up anyone who was around. It didn't matter who it was. They would pick 10, 15, 20 people, and they would murder them. But anyway, it was not the most comfortable place to be anyway, but it was better than being in Paris. We would, what can I say, we since we didn't have very much food, I would go with my cousin to pick berries. We would go to find that area is has a lot of walnuts. Walnuts and chestnuts. So we would go in the forest and try to gather chestnuts. Of course, it was very filling because we could cook them and eat that. The walnuts belonged to people, but whatever was hanging outside on the road, whatever fell on the road, well, belonged to everyone. So we picked the chestnuts, I mean the walnuts, and when we had a certain amount of those walnuts, we ate some, but the rest was serving to make oil. We found a place which would make walnut oil, because we had absolutely nothing to cook with. So it really was very interesting.
Well, I hesitate to ask a question, but I think I'll ask it and then we'll change the tape. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that you knew about the invasion of Normandy. When we resume the next tape, if you could tell me what news you did have during the war of what was going on.
Yeah.
But I'm going to ask you to hold on to that. tape 5 of the interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen. You were about to tell us about how you learned about what was going on, what the course of the war was.
Well, we didn't have a radio, that's for sure. And we knew some people who were in the underground, at least the parents of, and the young men or the young women would come once in a while and fill us in on what was happening. And of course, a lot was things that were not always true. People heard something from someone else. But in this case, it seems that there was some truth to it. And the people in the underground knew pretty much what was going on, really, because, not that much, but they knew enough, because they went in contact with either London or whoever was their heads, and they needed to know, because they also needed to, some words were passed to them, you know, if the baker is baking his bread or whatever, so and so was supposed to go and blow up the train, rail, or whatever it was. So anyway, that's the way we knew. We were not 100% sure of what was going on, but we learned little things, and one learned a little thing, and the other one something else, and we sort of pieced it together. That's how we learned.
How often were you in contact with your aunt and your cousin?
Well, we would go there once in a while, or they would come once in a while, because, of course, there was no telephone and no other way, but we walk. They would walk over, or they would walk over, and eventually, I think my aunt and my cousin, it seems to me, got a place in town also, and we would just walk in, because where would we go? We were always nearby it, you know, we were not very far, so that's the way we were in contact with one another.
Were you aware of? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, my aunt had found also a way of making a little money, because she was just as short of money as we were. There was a big lab in the area, and she found a job washing bottles and doing sterilizing things or things of that nature. And it brought a little money, not much, and she had to walk, unfortunately, on foot in the snow to the lab and back. But that's all she could do. We really needed to have money, and we couldn't work there unless it was something like that, menial things. And everyone was at this point doing sort of menial things if they were not in their own locale.
Were you aware of any other Jewish families or Jewish refugees? And if so, how could you detect them as Jews?
I think, I am not quite sure how we detected them, but we knew they were other families. And eventually we hooked up with some of them, and one was the Kornblum family. And this man was with his wife, and he had three children at the time, I believe, and his wife was very pregnant with the fourth, and he was there with his mother. They were all in hiding, came from Paris. He had found a job. I don't know what he was doing, I'm not sure. And at one of these incidents where a militia man was killed, they decided to round up a whole bunch of people. You didn't have to be a Jew. Anyone would do. And they rounded up 15, 20, I really don't recall how many people. They tortured them, you know, by pulling teeth, tongues, I mean, not teeth, nails. And eventually they shot them. And this man, this Mr. Kornblum, was one of them. It was a very difficult moment, and especially this woman was about to give birth. She was maybe 8 months pregnant. It was the older mother of that man who was shot. And there were the little children. And what is, I sort of vaguely remembered the funeral. I don't know if there was some kind of a Jewish funeral or not, but I know when he was buried, it's very possible that someone said a Kaddish at the graveyard, but I remember when he was buried, his old mother was hysterical. She wanted to jump in this pit with him. It was her only son. And it was just horrible. And here was this his wife, three little kids, the wife very pregnant. That was a funeral. What I must say is that the people in Voiron got notice of this woman who was about to give birth, and she gave birth like a week or 2 weeks later. And amazingly enough, they all knew that they were refugees because they all spoke good French except for the mother. And everyone rallied around this family. They were given all sorts of things for the baby. And I must say that there was a tremendous amount of solidarity for the family. They gave them all sorts of things. I don't know if they got money too, but here was the breadwinner who had his wife, his then four children, plus the mother, and all of a sudden it all stopped. So I think they got some kind of help. And I'm not sure when this happened exactly. It happened sometimes in 44, obviously before August, but I'm not absolutely sure if it was July or June, or it was before we got liberated.
Could you describe the circumstances leading up to or just prior to the liberation? And
Everyone was very anxious, waiting with tremendous trepidation this liberation. We heard that the Americans and the Free French were liberating Paris. And I can't remember if we were liberated a few days after Paris or vice versa. I think Paris was liberated before we were, in August 21st, 2nd, 3rd of 44. And we were liberated at that point too. And I remember the Americans coming with on their jeeps, and here was this population who didn't have very much to eat, and many were in hiding, and they were sort of weakened. And here were the Americans, full of health and of vigor, and they were chewing gum to the children, and also little crackers, which I don't remember what they were. They were wonderful, little tiny crackers. It was from the Russian, and I think some people got also something like Spam, whatever it was. Well, everyone was extremely grateful and happy about that. But more than anything, they were so happy to see them liberating us. So that was in August 44, not 20, 23rd, 19, whatever, about that time. And after that, we felt that things were going to unravel fast, that we could sort of pack up and leave and go back to Paris, since they were liberated too. But that was not quite, not so fast. There were no trains. There was nothing, which everyone was dispersed. Everyone was displaced. Everyone wanted to go back. If you were south, you wanted to go east or west or north. There were not enough trains. There were very few trains. Many of the tracks had been damaged by bombings. So we tried from August till November of 44 to get back. Couldn't get back. It's finally we managed to get back to Paris in November of 44. And, of course, the trains were packed to capacity. It was standing room only, and this was far. We had to stand all night. And We were really completely packed like in cages. But we got back in November. I don't remember if it was beginning of November or mid-November, whenever. And of course, when we came back, we learned that my grandmother's apartment had been emptied out. The Germans had taken everything out. And despite the fact that the Martins continued paying rent and no one said, don't pay rent. And not only that, but it had been rented to some other people since it was empty. Then people looked for empty places. It was re-rented to another family. So the only place which remained okay was my mother's apartment. So we moved into it, my grandmother and myself. And we, registered to go back to school immediately. Went back to school. And the classes were absolutely packed to capacity because many had been away, like I had been, and kids came back. I remember the class I was in had 52 people, 52 kids. It was we were so packed. And I got my sort of the equivalency of the high school diploma in June or July. Don't forget when we had the exam. Either June or July of 45. And
so in 1 year, one school year, you made up all those
less. Less, yes, than one school year, right. I had a teacher who was very nice, who was helping me. She did a little tutoring, and we gave her whatever we could afford. She was very nice to make up the gaps, and there were quite a few gaps. But I had always been a good student, and when I stopped going to school, it happened that I jumped one class because I was 1 year ahead. I was a very good student. Okay, so I had less to make up, if you want, having been 1 year ahead. So I managed and I passed the exam. But before that, the teachers wanted to know who wanted to continue going to higher education. But again, the classes everywhere, lycées and so on, were totally packed. So you couldn't, whoever made grades, go in. It was by competition. You had a certain spots allocated, and you couldn't go more than that if you had 20 or 50 or whatever. The ones who had done the best in their competition, the exams, would be taken. I was interested in continuing, so my teacher arranged so I would pass the exam, and I was accepted. I remember 19th, which was wonderful. Number 19 is pretty good, out of a huge number of students. And after I passed this equivalence of whatever, I think it's high school diploma, I started to go to this school which would give me higher education. Unfortunately, I couldn't go there very long because I really needed money. I didn't have any money, and there was no sign of my mother coming back or anyone coming back. And it really was very difficult. So after a few months, I dropped out. And with the help again of the OSE, the Œuvre de Secours aux Enfants, they had a school at that point, many deportees were coming back, children like Elie Wiesel, 15, 16 years old. And and they had a school, a dental school, where they were going to train those boys to be I don't know what you call that to make teeth.
Go ahead.
Not to be dentists, but to be the technicians to make the teeth. And the girls apparently were not good enough for that. They were going to be good enough to be assisting the dentist, you know, pass the instruments or what have you. So that's what I started to do. I registered for that school, and I thought, well, I was going to be able to work much faster and do something.
Was this like an art school for Jewish students?
It was for Jewish students because the dentist was Jewish, and it was a dispensary, and they had they were training children, and most of the children who came, the young adolescents, were really had been in camps. Buchenwald, most of them. So here I was with a few others, and after a few months it became also clear that that was not going to work either, because I really didn't want to be just doing that, passing instruments and so on and cleaning away things. So I dropped out of that, and I really, really needed to work. I needed money. So I had a friend from school who said, look, I started to work at this place. It happened to be a Jewish kind of stockbroker. And I said, why don't you apply, and maybe that would be a good place for you to start, and you can always, maybe if your family comes back, go back to school or whatever. So I did apply, and I started to work there. I think in January of 47, maybe, or maybe January 48. You see, I can't remember. I was very young. They accepted me. I filled out an application, and they said, well, okay, they were going to teach me whatever. And it really didn't matter. They didn't pay very much, but at least it was some money coming in, a little money. In the meantime, we had there was some sort of a trial to get the people out of the apartment of my grandmother, because they were there really totally legally, since she had a lease. She was paying. It's not as if she wasn't paying. It was bad enough that the Germans cleared up everything she had, all her furniture and everything there was in it. So it took, I don't know how long it took, but it took a little, maybe a year or so, until she managed to get the people out and could get back to her own place. But then we were not about to give up my mother's place, because finding an apartment was like finding a gold coin in a hay of stack of hay, rather. So she went to live there, and I lived alone in my mother's apartment, still hoping maybe she'd come back. But it became painfully clear that she wasn't coming back. So I started to work, and I was living by myself. Must have been 16 something, wasn't 17 yet. And my grandmother would come and visit. She had the keys of the apartment, so she could supervise. And every Saturday, we'd all have lunch at my grandmother's place. It would be the only ones left was my aunt, my Bernard, my cousin, and me, the four of us. That was it. The main family was there. So we'd have lunch there. When there were holidays, we'd have Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, whatever holiday, we'd be with my grandmother. And that's the way we did it. I continued working at this place. In fact, I worked there all the time, but I was lucky enough to get on a little bit with in the echelon, so to speak. The way it happened is I was working, it was pretty menial work because I wasn't trained for anything, but I had to work, and I started to take courses. So I could work, have a little money, not much, and start courses. So I would sort of catching up some. I think it was in the spring of 49, maybe early spring of 49, the stock market reopened, what they call the gold market, with the coins and all of that. And by then, people were back. I really can't remember if it was in 48 or in 49. I think it was in 48. That was in 48. They opened the stock market, and there was someone, a Jewish man by the name of Serge Rosenberg, who opened the market. He was asked by my big boss to open it because he knew how to deal with this sort of thing, gold coins. And he had a partner by the name of Jean Houillon. And Serge Rosenberg, came first because the two had a business, and Jean Houillon had to sort of settle the business before he could come, so it was another few months. In the meantime, Serge Rosenberg asked my big boss if there was anyone that he could recommend who would be bright enough or intelligent enough who would be able to work with him, that he would like to teach them. Well, I had a couple of different places in the firm, which was about 100 people. It didn't quite work out too well because they were always not very nice, let's put it this way. And a young, very young person having no one to defend her, that was fair game. Well, and I didn't.
Were there many other young girls there?
There were some, but there was really no one in my situation, you see. Anyway, the big boss, André Perles, was someone who liked me very much, fortunately, and they were Jews, which helped too, because they had also been in hiding. They were all French Jews, but they had been in hiding. And anyway, when Serge Rosenberg asked for someone who had a brain and could maybe work with him, he picked me. And he said, okay, we're going to take her for a week and see if this works out. And if not, we'll find someone else. Well, after 2 days, this Serge Rosenberg said, it's going to work out fine. She is very bright. It's going to work out. She gets it. She is reliable. I mean, I was an adult, you know. Anyway, it worked out. And I stayed in this office with him. And then Jean Yon came, and we got a few other people who came. But I stayed in this office for almost ever, I mean, for a long, long time. I was a sort of gold specialist. I was, you know, could recognize gold coins from false ones, from the real ones. And I had a very good eye, was very fast. It worked out very well. But I was also doing some other stuff. They started after a while to do a newspaper that they would send the clients every 2 weeks, I think. And it was a special way of doing it on aluminum, kind of. It's a very strange typewriter thing. So they sent me to school to learn that, because that was also very specialized, and learned it, no problem. So I was wearing two hats in a way. I was doing this every other week, doing that kind of work. And as I said, in the meantime, very fortunately, Serge Rosenberg and Jean Houillon became, again, like surrogate, parents. One was Jewish, the other one was not, but the two had been friends forever. And again, nicer people you could not find. And until ever, Jean Yon came to visit us here several times, so it's just we were very good friends. It was really, they were wonderful people. So I was lucky. In the meantime, of course, I made friends with other people, and I was very lucky to find, very nice people. I don't know if it's because I was okay, but I found my way to good people, which is lucky.
I'm curious to ask what the general demeanor of the French people was when Jews came back from hiding or from camps, if there was any acknowledgement of what had happened, if the French countrymen took any responsibility for not doing more to protect their...
I don't think there was. There were the ones who had been wonderful people, like, for example, the Martins, who couldn't do enough, really, to be helpful, to do whatever they could, and hated the Germans with a passion. And there were the others who were indifferent, who didn't do anything, and there were the ones who were German sympathizers. There was that too, because I remember in Voiron, before we got back, there were some people who had been collaborators, sort of, and I remember they were gathering women who had collaborated, had been with the Germans, and they would bring them in front of the main plaza, which had the church, main church area, and they would shave the heads of all these women, and people screaming and yelling. Again, it seemed that it was right at the time, but I think it was not right because it was judging. And some people, I have no doubts, were guilty as could be, but I'm sure that others were not. They were probably caught at the wrong place at the wrong time. But again, it was, I think, quite scary for a young child to see all that, to see the hysteria of the French. And how you can turn around 1 minute, do one thing, and 1 minute, do something else. It was not a pleasant sight and a very scary sight because there was a lot of, not maybe fist fights, but some of that too. And it was very scary. And I can tell you that what I can remember more than anything during the whole war is being so scared about everything or everyone. Someone walking behind me, maybe he was the one who was going to do me in. It was fear, constant fear.
We're going to change the tape now. tape 6 of the interview with Rose-Helene Spreiregen. I'm curious to know if you have any residual fears or sense of insecurity as a consequence of those early wartime experiences.
I certainly do. I am, to this day, very insecure, very sensitive to people and to my environment. In a way, I have some interesting, silly little things. When I get somewhere, I like to know where the door is in case I have to leave. I cannot stand having something cluttering, not preventing me from leaving if I had to, for whatever reason, and we know what the reasons are. I am insecure in a sense, knowing also that there was no one for me when I should have been taken care of. I was the one, in fact, who took care of an adult, in a way. I didn't have a childhood. I was robbed of this childhood completely. And it forced me to become quite mature when I should have been a child. And insecurity, yes. I'm very insecure to this day. And I never believe that I can do anything as well as anyone else. My husband always says, you can do things far better than so-and-so. But I don't believe that. I don't see this that way. I kept this insecurity, yes. And I'm still very fearful of certain things which the slightest thing can trigger a recall. And I could see that something could happen or might happen before anyone else. And sometimes it does, because I'm so ultra-sensitive to situations or to people. Yes, I'm very insecure.
Did your Holocaust experiences influence your feelings about God or Judaism?
If anything, it turned me away from Judaism and from God. Not that I was any a devout Jew. My grandmother was. My mother was really not. My uncle wasn't either. But it made me feel that I wanted to run away, because I felt so punished for being a Jew, not having done anything, and not having been a bad person. I didn't feel that I wanted to be very Jewish. And I must say that after the war, I did not go around broadcasting that I was Jewish. When I made friends, and I made many non-Jewish friends, many good friends, since I was so rejected as a child because I was a Jew, I wanted them to, how should I put this, to know me well before I told them. And then I would tell them that I was Jewish. And then, if they rejected me, it was because of who I was, not because I was a Jew. And that made a difference. It made me feel a little bit more, well, I wouldn't say secure, but at least I didn't feel as bad. If they knew me and they didn't like the kind of person I was, that was perfectly okay. I could take that. But if they rejected me because I was Jewish, this was not okay.
Do you think there have been life choices or decisions you've made that were influenced by your wartime experiences?
Not really. I don't think so. My choices were really that I had to fend for myself all the time, so I had to see what was okay for me, how I could manage whatever it was, whatever situation I was. And I lived alone until I got married in October 61. So for many years, I had really to fend for myself. And I worked and took classes, and I tried to... I may not have had a formal education, but I had an education. I read a lot, and I was trying to make up what I didn't have in a more classical way by myself. And again, fortunately, I had very nice friends like Serge Rosenberg, Jean Huyon, the Dreyfuses, who were very good friends, who were there for me, who were very helpful, who gave me advice, who gave me support. You know, when I thought that, well, it was not going to work out, I said, no, it's going to, you can do that. And so it was very, very helpful.
Was it difficult for you to leave France after you got married?
Was it difficult? Yes, it was. My grandmother was then 80. It was almost 81. And it was very difficult, yes, because I didn't want to go. I felt that I was going to abandon her, although I promised that no matter what, I'd come back to see her once a year, which I did. And my cousin was there. He would continue to go visit. My aunt would continue to go visit. But I felt that I was the person who was really responsible for her, for my grandmother. So, yes, I was very uncomfortable leaving. I didn't like that, but on the other hand, my grandmother liked my husband. She approved of him. He was Jewish. God forbid I should have found someone who was not. She would have killed me. She really liked him a lot, but I had to go. And that was not so simple, not so easy. But I did write to her because during the time that we were afraid that we may be separated, my grandmother taught me to write Yiddish because we only spoke Yiddish together. So I wrote Yiddish. And during all these years, until she got blind, really, the last couple of years, I wrote to her in Yiddish, and she would write back in Yiddish. So in those days, there was no telephone. So we did that, and I always wrote to her. And what can I say? When she became blind, she couldn't really write. So she had my very good friend Jean Huyon would go to visit her. She was an old age home at some point. I had to put her there in what year was that? 69? Maybe 69. And 69, because she became bedridden and she was blind. She couldn't walk anymore. And this was one of the most painful things I had to do. My grandmother continued to be very orthodox despite everything. And I'd said to her once, but what do you do now? You can't light candles or anything. She said, oh, it doesn't matter. When on Friday night when they turn on the lights, I say the prayer as if it was candles.
Have you talked about your wartime experiences with your husband, with any other people?
Yeah, a little of this and a little of that, but never in a orderly way. And spatulas. I don't really talk about it to some people who are not really interested, and most people really are not interested.
Well, I would like to thank you for talking about your experiences to us and for making sure that the historical record is as complete as possible. And I know this is a difficult undertaking, and I'd like to express our appreciation.
Thank you. Well, the photo that we see here is my mother, my grandmother, and my uncle, which is to say it's a brother.
Could you name them, please? For us again.
Right. This is my mother, Rivka, my grandmother, Sarah, and my uncle, Shmuel. And this picture was taken, I have no idea when, but it was taken in Warsaw, Poland. And it might have been taken, well, my mother seems to be maybe 15 or 16. So she is born in 1911. So this would have been mid-20s, maybe. Mid-20s.
Okay, and the family name was?
Bester. This is my mother and my father on their wedding. I believe it was in 1929. My mother is Rivka Bester, and my father's name is David Beinfeldzweig.
And what? And where was this picture
taken? I think it was taken in Paris. This is my uncle Shmuel Bester and my aunt Chaya Bester. Well, her name, her maiden name was Goldberg, I think. I'm not sure. Anyway, this is their wedding picture. They were married in March 1933 in Paris.
And tell me which uncle this is.
This is my mother's brother. Am I tapped? Okay. This is me.
Your name?
My name is Rose-Helene Spreiregen, when I was about 2.5 years old in Paris.
And what year would that be?
This was sent the 1st of January 34, so it was taken in December of 33. I was about 2.5 years old. This is a photo of my uncle, Samuel Bester. He is the second from the left in the second row, and he volunteered in the army probably in September 39. After a few months, he was discharged because he got hepatitis, and they all thought that this was a terrific thing. Unfortunately, it was not, because his unit was made prisoner and he was left in Paris to be deported and never came back. These photos, the one on the left is in Savigny-sur-Bray, where we had been evacuated at the beginning of the war, children and elder people, and that's where we were. And this was taken early 1940. The little boy on the left is my cousin Bernard. Bester. That's me and the white dress in front. Behind, my cousin Bernard is obviously a friend of my grandmother, but I don't remember her. And holding me is my grandmother, Sarah Bester. The photo on the right is my cousin Bernard Bester, and this is my uncle Schmiel Bester, who is the son of my grandmother here.
And so this is after he was released from the army because of his hepatitis?
Yes. Yes. This was early 1940. This is a paper that I got not that long ago, I guess in May or June of 98 when we were in Paris. There is the Jewish archives, and they have all these files. And this one shows that the date my mother was shipped out of Drancy, where she was in a holding, to Auschwitz. And it gives the date, which is August 1942. It was shipped to Berlin, to Oranienburg, to Auschwitz. I cannot say very much more since it's in German, and I don't know German that much, that well. This document shows the list of the people who were being sent to Auschwitz. My mother on this paper is number 443, and it is slightly misspelled. Instead of a B, there is a D, like Dennis. It shows the birth weight, where the person was born and what the nationality the person was, the number of the wagon, here it says 20, and this was part of the convoy. At this point, I must say that I had learned from Mrs. Greenspan, who was at Transy at the time, that some volunteers were asked for convoys of children. And my mother volunteered, hoping that it would be a good thing for the children, for herself. Unfortunately, years later, I learned that the volunteers with the convoys of children were either dead on arrival or gassed on arrival. And if you can see the dates of birth of these people, this is one sheet out of a number, since the convoy was for about 1,000. You can see that some children are as young as 2 years old or 3 or 4 years old, which is, I guess, the convoy in which my mother left. This document is part of the two other ones, and it seems that it shows that it's the convoy is leaving Drancy, and it's the wagon 21. I can't say very much more about that because I really do not know how to read it. Okay, this is a picture, the person on the right, it's me, with someone I had befriended when I was in Voiron in hiding on the false ID. And this was taken in April 1944. This picture is of my uncle, Samuel Beinwaldzweig, and his wife. He is the brother of my father, and this dog is, their dog is Flux. It was in his little country place that they had near Paris. And this was taken in summer of 47, and he died a few months later in January of 48. He was really an absolutely wonderful person. He is the one who introduced me to the opera, who always would send me by tickets, and who would always tell me who I was supposed to get rather than not, who was playing that night and who was not. I mean, he really was a great connoisseur of opera, and he is the one who introduced me to that kind of love. These two photos were when I was in vocational dental school. This was in 46 or so. I'm not exactly sure of the exact dates, but the picture on the left was really mostly young people who had come back from Buchenwald, who had been in Buchenwald and came back, and some came from Poland originally, or from Czechoslovakia, and were transiting to France, in fact, trying to find a relative either in Australia or America or Israel, which wasn't Israel yet, but was Palestine, to take them in. So since they had lost their family and came back from camps, the picture on the right was part of the staff and some of the girls who went to, had been in hiding, but not in camps. What else is there?
Did any of them, those that had been in Buchenwald, did they share their experiences with you or talk among themselves about it?
They may have talked among themselves, but they never shared with us, who had only been in hiding, and what did we suffer? Not much compared to them, it's obvious. They never talked to us about it, and I guess being so young and so wrapped up with the things which had just happened to me, I guess I was, I didn't even think of asking any questions, and I guess we all wanted to get it over with and just go on with our lives and live. This is a picture of me in the Alps somewhere in 1956, skiing and having lost my childhood, having been in hiding, not having been able to do anything. After the war, I tried to do all the different things that normal people used to do and were doing. So this is my attempt at starting to ski, and of course I have skied ever since and continue to ski. Net? Okay. This is me at work, beginning of 57. Here I am typing, which I was doing, but also to the right. First of all, there is a colleague of mine, and to the between this colleague and myself, there is a big safe, which is open, and you can see all the gold. Since I was doing, I was really specializing in gold coins, which I knew how to detect the good ones from the bad ones. This is me in Palma de Mallorca in 1959, trying to do what everyone was always doing, swimming and enjoying myself, going on vacation, and trying to have fun. This is me and my husband getting married in Paris, the 22nd of October 1961. To the head that you see on the right is my cousin Bernard, who is the one who brought me to the Europa. And this is, I guess, the ketubah and the rabbi who married us in Paris. I met my husband actually when I came on vacation to the United States a few months before that, and he was one of my contacts. I had quite a few contacts from my friends who made sure I had contacts in Boston and Washington and New York, and he was my Washington contact. So we met, I went back to Paris, and well, the rest is history.
And your husband's name?
My husband's name is Paul Spreiregen. This is a picture of my wedding with my husband, Paul, taken in Paris at the reception hall. This was October 22nd, 1961. On my side, there are the people who remained. My grandmother is standing next to me, my cousin Bernard, and my aunt, Chaya.
Is that Bernard's
mother? Bernard's mother. And those were the remnants of the close family. And next to her is her son, Felix, and her husband, Daniel, who she remarried after the war when my uncle didn't come back. On the left of side of the picture is next to my husband is his mother, Janet Spreiregen. His uncle, Sam Zisman, his older sister, Naomi Schumann, and her husband, Harold Schumann. I have to mention also that Samuel Zisman, who is next to my mother-in-law, his sister, and his niece, my sister-in-law, Samuel B. Zisman was, after the war, the head of the UNRWA division in Bavaria, and he brought back a lot of papers from the DP camps, and those he unfortunately died a number of years ago, and we had these papers, and my husband went through them all and donated all his papers pertaining to the UNRWA to the Holocaust Museum. So they are in good hands now.
This completes the interview of Rose-Helene Spreiregen.